Welcome back, everyone, to game number two here between Burden United and Balkan Bears, where we're looking at BBC a little bit down in the dumps. Burden took the game to them and really roughed them up. So we'll see what happens in game number two. I'm Durka here in the JD Studios. Joining me tonight is Blaze for the final game of the night. How are you feeling about this series?
Well, I feel like Burden United have a pretty firm grasp of what they want to accomplish in these games here. They know the weakness is that Weehaw. A lot of hinges on him to make the plays happen, to make ganks occur at the right timing window. And it's going to be ever true on this Storm Spirit. It was true on the Lina. It's going to be true in the Storm. And if they can respond to that with quick disables on him, they should be in a pretty good place to just, in general, look at this game and say, we can find the timing we need to. The one thing that they might be a little bit concerned about is this draft is very different from BBC. Earthshaker's a great hero to turtle up with, and Batrider's insane in the late game. Storm Spirit might just be a tempo controller that enables them to get crazy farm onto Attila's safe lane carry.
Well, they've got a couple of heroes here who are pretty competent at finding that PL and locking him down. No, once you get Orchid up on Storm Spirit, you zip in there with Vortex and silence him up so you can't doppelganger away. Batrider with the lasso, same story. But that Shadow Fiend pick really does mess up their lanes a little bit. Because now the Storm Spirit won't get dedicated confirmed farm at the mid lane. He'll have to go into the jungle and take a couple of stacks here and there. But that's where you want Batrider to be. He's definitely not going to have a good time in that offlane. PL spamming out Lancers and Vengeful Spirit with Wave of Terror and Magic Missile. BBC need to stack up jungle camps for him, so I'm wondering if we'll see the Earthshaker in that holding role, you know, mid, between mid and top, stacking up camps for the bat while Storm Spirit tries to maybe get a kill in the SF. Then you're looking at one role hero and safe lane support for BBC. But what do they contend with here?
I really do think late game is still the answer. Shadow Fiend and Phantom Lancer take a lot of farm off of the map, so eventually they're going to be fighting against one another for that aspect. If you can get somebody that gets a lot of value out of farm density, you mentioned the Spectre before, she's really good. Medusa would not be a really good option because of the Diffusal Blade factor for Phantom Lancer, so I would say any kind of late game hero like that. Spectre, Slark can do a lot of work, obviously. Darkopter wasn't bad, but it just didn't seem to be executed the way they needed it to. So, yeah, overall, I would say less reliance on stacks necessarily, and just get more farm density on a single hero, and that's going to be able to carry it to the late game. But they're looking at a little bit of control, a little bit of push. The Shadow Shaman is a pickup that's kind of really seen a resurgence. He definitely isn't one that you'd say that's been really popular the past few months, but this past couple of weeks, he's really started to get back into that metagame a little bit. People like to take objectives with those wards, and of course, getting a lot of control is going to be a key thing. Blink Hex against Phantom Lancer would probably be the way to seal the deal on a difficult late game circumstance.
Have we seen a lot of Rasta in the European scene? Because I know I've seen him in China with IG and people picking him up, but who in Europe has been playing him?
I'm trying to remember. There's been a couple of teams, but it is still a very uncommon selection.
Yeah. It's always seemed to me as, you know, Lion has been on the forefront because he can play so aggressively. He's got the double disable, he's self-sustaining with the mana drain, and then Finger of Death is that great single target nuke. Shadow Shaman with Aether Shock and Hex, you know, sure, they're great, but Shackle, it disables you at the same time as you disable someone, so you don't have the same mobility that Lion does in zoning out one target and then moving on to the next. You know, that's one of Lion's biggest strengths, the fact that you can hex someone and then run deeper into the fight to get a two-man Earth Spike onto someone else. But Shadow Shaman does offer you something different. Serpent Wards, you mentioned, will definitely help you push into towers. Batrider, with that zoning effect where he can hide in the trees, Firefly up, and the threat of that lasso is definitely enough to just maybe give up a couple of tier 1 towers early. And as I was saying that, they pick up a tree and protect us, so maybe not.
I thought the Train Protector might be an option for them. I was worried that it might not be good enough to control the Storm. Obviously, Magic Missile and Leech Seed are terrible against Ball Lightning, so they really do need to make sure their last hero is going to be able to find some semblance of hard lockdown, but either way, the support Tree and Protector is extremely powerful with the Shadow Fiend in this draft. Essentially, what they're going to do is, okay, we can't really roam and kill the Storm Spirit once he hits 6, but we can make his life miserable up until that point. Shadow Fiend Treant versus Storm is a very, very difficult matchup for the Storm Spirit. It just every single time that you give the Shadow Fiend living armor, he pulls ahead full creep wave in CS. So you're already saying that he's going to have to dip into his jungle against the Batrider. Well, now he's probably going to be forced out of lane with how well Shadow Fiend can trade hits and how difficult it's going to be to bring him down. Like, Shadow Shaman and Earthshaker now have to go for the roam, and there's going to be actually a Meepo here. So this is going to be Weehaw Classic. They generally last pick it. They did actually, against a lesser team, try to go for it as a second pick, and it got crazy countered. So nowadays, they only fourth or fifth pick it. And in this case, I don't know, Burden United probably saw it coming as a possibility, but whether or not they're fully prepared for it, we'll see.
Well, Meepo's going to be good at clearing out those PL illusions, and again, they've got that focus. They're going to be able to lock down the PL with a net, stop him from jumping around as much as he does, and take him out. But Burden, with their fifth pick, they could potentially, you know, send Treant into the offlane here. We've seen that a couple of times. FNG has been playing it, recently in sort of a one-ish role, getting a hell of a lot of farm. We've seen it from Vega and Empire running it as an offlaner. A couple of American teams as well. I think it was Summer's Rift that ran it offlane once. But I'm pretty damn sure it's going to be that safe lane support. Treant maybe run around trying to find a couple of kills here. So Sotchka's hero. What are we looking at here? There's plenty out there. You know, the Batrider's taken already. Brewmaster's banned out. Spirit Breaker. Balkan Bears don't want him having any of those heroes. There's still things like Clockwork. But how good is a Clockwork against things like
ESO? Oh, that's it. That is a hell of a pick. Yeah, I'm actually surprised he went through all the way to the last pick here. But that is a really good one. I like Timbersaw for dealing damage to Meepo. But since I lack so much control, the axe is 10 times better. Able to do good physical damage as they strike him. And, of course, getting the lockdown against them. This is what they needed. Because, actually, they already have a lot of great tools at their disposal. The Shadow Fiend's Requiem is one of the best spells you can have against Meepo. Because it reduces all their damage in half. And they're all running base damage. It's really impactful. Of course, it's great AoE magical, too. So getting the axe to have the control, following it up, singling out a Meepo maybe with a swap out from Come With Me, suddenly that's a dead Weehaw, and BBC are going to have trouble actually responding to that. So I think the emphasis here has to be on BBC starting the fights. Batrider, Storm are great heroes to do so. Earthshaker has some situations where he can as well. So it really comes down to everybody getting Blink Daggers, or in Storm's case, just a ton of mana. They really need to emphasize aggression, initiation, because if they get jumped on, it's going to get dicey.
Yeah, couldn't agree more. For those of you just joining us, this is game number two here in this two-game series between Balkan Bears and Burden United in the D2CL European group stage. Game number one went the way of Burden, while BBC are looking to grab one back. They're now at, 3-6, down near the bottom of the group, while BU are 8-1, definitely leading the pack with the amount of wins they've got.
Yep, so Bounty Rune up top is going to be secured. I believe they're emphasizing Necroman here. They really want to make sure that he has the best lane he can, but Sing Sing's closer, so it looks like that's going to be their choice here. Paris probably shouldn't attempt this, but at least you would think. In the bottom rune, everybody's missing on the Radiant side. Yeah, he's not going to even try, even though technically, as we see from our bird's eye view, it's only the Meepo here, which is kind of surprising. But a bluff will work nevertheless, and Paris is going to focus on blocking out that lane. And do you think he's going to get a decent ward down? Like, he didn't even focus on that at the beginning.
I'm not too sure. Quite often I've seen offlane heroes running around with this Observer ward and never really place it. Never place it in a position where they see the supports moving in, give them that defensive capabilities. They hold it until, you know, 3 or so minutes in, and then place it just somewhere on the rune spot, somewhere that's not going to get dewarded. Mid lane, we're already seeing the aggression from Mind Nuts throwing down the Leech Seed and annoying the hell out of that Storm Spirit. As Necroman takes the early CS lead, 2-0, the first wave going almost entirely his way.
Yeah, it definitely helps with that first wave, which is most important for Shadow Fiend, the Necromastery and all. But yeah, it's still kind of surprising that he trades that hard, because he's going to be chopping down the entire forest and seems to be contradictory to protecting it. But yeah, either way, he'll make his rotation down bottom, and they'll be able to actually control this quadrant of the map. And that means they can maybe see where the stacks are, and Paris could look to steal those in a couple of levels. And Weehaw in general is just not going to get the same timing he'd like.
Oh man, how does Weehaw go in for last hits here? It's not like there's a Lion or a Rubick, Witch Doctor, Sansa. You know, Shadow Shaman is decent at zoning people out, but as long as it's him against one other hero. throw down the level 1 Aether Shock. Get some right clicks in there.
Wow, there's so much damage going into Attila here. It's actually, like, you make a really good point in the sense that Earthshaker is glued to the mid lane. Storm has such a hard lane ahead of him that Earthshaker can't do anything but just stack and stay here. And he's going to get a triple with this Western hard camp, but in general, Storm Spirit is just so far behind. And that means that it is going to be only the Shadow Shaman to contribute 2v2.
They've got, like, one lane going decently for them. That's the top lane. The Batrider not doing too badly here. We'll actually get that D ward. So the ward that's blocking up this large camp, come with me. Trading hits. The Batrider stunned up now. Sing Sing walks in, but Sticky Napalm and Firefly, is this really what you want to battle up into? They've got to give this ward up regardless. And that will allow the Batrider to pull across. The attempted deny, but miss uphill from the Batrider screwing up that plan. But bot lane. Bot lane! Shadow Shaman stunned up and taken out by Minots and Paris as Weehaw ensnares them and traps them, but Living Armor keeping them all healthy.
Yeah, that's definitely a problem here. I'm getting a visual bug as far as the Dire Observer ward that's down in this area. I see it on the minimap, but I don't see it in actuality. But beyond that, I think the Batrider, he's doing so well because, of course, the Trant is bottom, but also because, like, he made sure that the Venge has absolutely nothing to do. He blocked off the pull with the ward. He has sentried out her lane ward, so it's really difficult for her to know what's what, and that's a big difference there. But Batrider, I think he can actually stick to the offlane. This might solve their problem a little bit. If Meepo gets the stacks and Batrider doesn't even bother with the jungle, it'll be a lot better for them, but it doesn't seem like that's the case. Masakari, he claims the Western camp, probably this one just to the north as well. And as such, it's not going to fix their problem. You said their top lane is the only one to really succeed again, and obviously we saw Fallout, he had to go back to base, but now that successful lane, quote-unquote, is actually leeching away from his team's potential to pull forward.
Well, this is another problem that I see with, you know, a fair amount of Tier 2, Tier 3 European teams is in the drafting phase, they pick up multiple heroes that require or would like to have the jungle as a fallback mechanism. With Meepo, you know, you mentioned giving him the jungle would be nice. Get him up into the Aghanims or into the Blink early on. But Batrider needs his Blink. Storm Spirit is being crushed on this mid lane. He's done a great job at coming back. But he's still looking at 25 CS up against 17. He'll take this wave out and probably even up. Well, almost even up. But rune control is definitely not in his favor.
Yeah, the bottom rune is what he needs, but I don't think he's going to get it. He will exhaust his entire HP pool, and again, he doesn't have camps to farm. If he didn't have HP, but he did have mana, that's fine. Just use your static remnant, clear out a double stack. But in this case, he's going to make a dangerous play down to the rune, and there's going to be a fight down bottom. Minus dropping low, the heal. Oh, gets right back into the trap, and Weehaw finishes him off. That was a very greedy play coming in for Minots, and it does cost them a 2-for-1.
That looked a little bit messy. I was wondering what Weehaw was doing. He's running around, holding onto the ensnare, holding onto the poof, not actually doing anything, just trying to dodge out the axe. Shackles came down, he chased the tree in a little bit, then moved back in. But in the end, the trade they get is definitely worth it, but maybe not anymore. Soshka on the charge with the tranquil boots. Poof. Weehaw, run. What's your escape route? A good fisher, maybe. Okay, then into the ensnare. He'll manage to get himself away for now. Still slowed down, and Soshka will back himself up. That was close.
I like the switch up of the aggro try here and just completely destroying the Meepo right when he's getting that big boost of experience. But it seems to have kind of failed a little bit in the sense that the Earthshaker, the Shadow Shaman, they're contributing a little bit more right now than just this Tree and Protector. He's very good defensively, but only offers one leech seed in the offensive sense, and that's not been enough so far. Great Fisher. And great use of the Earthbind as well. Now Fisher in mid, not even going to try for it. The Storm needed 6 to make an offensive play.
You know what's really annoying with Dota 2? Even though I've set Steam Friends to offline, okay, it stops the friend invites and all that nonsense for coming through. If people invite me to a game, it still has the freaking pop-up saying, really? Derpson has invited you to a game. No, I'm offline for a freaking reason.
I would blame your friends inviting you while you're casting a game. And offline, for that matter. I don't even know. But we see the jump in mid, and it should be the Shackles?
Well,
yeah,
Fisher.
With the Fisher.
The Living Arm is keeping him alive still. Still keeping him alive. There's not enough damage. Necromant turns back.
That's
and
so frustrating.
Selves himself up. The Ground Courier, 6 minutes in, not flying. Could have been a target there from the Radiant. No. He doesn't have boots, does he? No. Rasta does not have boots and gets taken out.
That's so frustrating. That's the power of the Treant right there. Just going ahead and turning a gank. That's a 3v1 on a Shadow Fiend. That's what you do to Shadow Fiend is you roam, you gank him with a numbers advantage, and you lock him down. And instead, they just turn it on his head, get a freebie for the Shadow Fiend, and now he's at maximum necromastery for level 3.
He's invis up a top lane. Triple raise here onto the Shadow Shaman kills him outright. He'll get the double, and that's more than enough. Masakari lance down onto him as the Batrider fireflies away. But this is looking rough for BBC. They've still got the Meepo, though. He's got his treads up, heading into the Aghanim Scepter more likely than not. Blink Dagger is the first item. Is decent, but you definitely want the farming potential and the influx of experience and gold from the extra Meepo clone.
Yep, so we'll see if they can really get that. Right now, their economy isn't really well managed. They're single stacks across the board, but they will be able to maybe get a kill in mid. Treant Protector, tanky, where's that taunt? Edela is actually going to get caught under the tower. Won't even get the tree. He gets dunked on. The Earthshaker dies in retreat. This Treant Protector is turning these fights left, right, and center.
Burden United. 2-6 right now as Axe goes back into the jungle. Blink Dagger, 700 gold, or 800 gold away. Weeha with 1400 needs that point booster up on him as the Batrider is still trying to find his blink. The Storm Spirit, you said he needs a good start. He is the item progression that, you know, any Storm would dream of, but he's definitely living a nightmare right now. 0-1-0, 33 last hits. Treads and Bottle lagging behind while Sing Sing, we've not even talked about him this game, mainly because he's been sitting up here farming for 10 minutes, well, 8 minutes. 0-0-0, 52 last hits, 23 denies, now pushing into the tier 1 tower. Vlad soaring and will more likely than not see the exact same item progression we did last game. Diffusal Blade, and then go run at people.
Kind of surprised he didn't at least get a magic stick against the Batrider, but it doesn't really matter in the end. It's going to be actually the Axe going down, just a quick pick. This is what Storms needed to do for a while, and the Living Armor was not used. So maybe just coming off cooldown, or maybe not enough to save his life. In either case, Storm's pretty good here to just jump down the cliff, and actually just going to go the long way around. So they could try to pincer him. He's going to go for this cliff instead, but Necroman, he's got the raises waiting for him, and he's waiting for the jump. Oh, big, big jump, though. Yeah. Okay, he's going to be fine. No! Check out Edel's inventory! He stole his Tranquils! No. He stole Axe's Tranquil Boots! I didn't even see that! He jumped over the cliff while Axe was farming, and he got the stun. And with the stun, he grabs the Tranquils, he steals the booties, and that's 1,000 gold gone for the Axe. It's not just a death. It's half of his Blink Dagger gone down the drain.
I'm definitely offline, and people are freaking invited. Stop it. Stop it now. Levy down on this bot lane. I don't know. He has to buy back his Tranquils. Soshka gonna really be annoyed by that. Storm Spirit gets up his Sol Ring. But it's not that big a loss. Like, sure enough, Tranquils, it's...
Are you kidding? I have to disagree with that statement entirely. I feel like that, like, they would have been dominating this game if they had a Blink Dagger in 200 gold. And instead, they're farming for another 5 minutes while Batrider gets to play. I do not agree with that sentiment.
So it's completely game-changing?
I mean, obviously, it depends on how the Meepo plays, but he's going to have this Aghanim at the same time the Axe is going to have Blink.
Oh,
I really feel like BU were about to just steamroll this game, and suddenly one quick pick, and it's up in the air.
We'll see where things go. I'm going to look at these supports on the Radiant side and think, okay, well, Brown Boots on both of them. Yapsaw with Fisher just trying to increase his farm a little bit. Yeah, I guess Soshka having to rebuy the Tranquil Boots. Well, how close was he to Blink? He was literally 200 gold away from it.
Well, he would have it now.
Damn. TPing down to the spot lane. They're going to find a pick onto Weehaw here. The Ensnare locks them both down, but Overgrowth and a couple of raises will pick him off.
No, they're going to try to make a smoke play with that Batrider lasso. Sing Sing. The Doppel doesn't come out in time. And yeah, he is certainly going to be chain stunned.
Oh man, BBC all guns blazing right now. That's going to be a confidence booster for you, if anything. Storm Spirit, what are we looking at net worth wise? You know, 11 minutes in, we've got almost 6k up on the Shadow Fiend, but item wise, he's going straight into that mech. So they'll be looking to pretty much 4-man or 5-man into these tier 1, tier 2 towers with the Treant and Axe, while mid lane, Minots goes invis. I'm not sure what his plan is there.
This is. I mean, they're getting space. They're controlling the map still with the tier one bottom kill. I like their item progression. Like the Shadow Fiend is gonna have, it does have mechanism, and the PL has Vlad's, so that's plus seven armor against the Meepo, which is really nice. The physical damage he's outputting isn't as big of a deal, and you have some extra heals to make sure that the Treant kicks in. I mean, you try to heal over time a dead man, and it's not really gonna help you. But I think the defensive item builds, while the aggressive play really suits what BU needs, but to play aggressively, you need that blink. And it does take a couple more minutes here. Still at an okay time, though. We'll see if it actually makes the difference.
Where do they go with it? They're going to have to try and smoke gang up onto the Meepo, try and get into the Radiant Jungle a little bit. They've stopped... You know, they did stop farming the farm in the Radiant Jungle quite a bit early on in the game. Just the threat of Axe and Treant running in there. But now, it's all open. We Are and Exist are both taking full advantage. Exist with the regen rune zipping back and forth into the Roche pit, jumping around. But I don't know, Sing Sing is still this guy up on top lane. He's died once with that pickup from Batrider, but he's farming so efficiently. TP's
up. They're actually gonna TP up here. Yeah, I don't know. Where are they really looking to find their control over the map? They have to make kind of stable movements as a whole. The smoke at a seat implies that they want to go for a two-man gank, and away they go. So Levi is going to be farming the mid lane. The bottom lane is going to be taken care of by Weeha, hopefully, if he doesn't get killed off by this axe. And then obviously they're looking to gank, I think, Sing Sing. But Weeha is pretty much already dead, given the position. As long as they find him in the fog, they didn't get vision of him. They had the range for sure, but they didn't scout it out. The smoke broke at a weird spot where it's hard to triangulate if he's east or west, and damn, they tunnel vision. Now Sing Sing caught out.
Lasso up, Yapsil with the Fissure. Can they finish him off though? Okay, with the Storm Jump again, Doppelganger leaps him over the Fissure actually. Storm expending more and more mana, but they've zoned in, they know which one's real, and take him out. Down to that bot lane though, Meepo was standing in like this odd little spot where the creep wave scouted them out, and into Roshan. Okay, DD's up in that
corner. DD and Wave of Terror, hell yeah. That's going to be a very nice rush time. And I don't think you get to do that if the Batrider didn't just lasso. So it's kind of the one cooldown exhausted to win it outright, and they don't have the detection for the mid. So they still get the tower, with thanks to the Mass Serpent Warts, which are these awesome Chinese dragons. But in the end, that's not nearly as impactful as this free Roche that is given to BU because they don't have the invasion tools. They don't have the lasso, and their Shaker obviously is still pretty poor. So for now, they take the Aegis on the SF, and he's going to be going for that Mech Yules build.
He's going to have like a 15 and a half minute, 16 minute Mech Yules treads, plus Ring of Ankula and Aegis Immortal. This is going to be a great step up for Bird and United just to push into towers. Well, I was mentioning it with the mech. It's great for 4 or 5 manning into these tier 1, possibly tier 2 towers. And with two of them still standing, the Radiant Jungle is a great place to just, you know, wander into with the rest of your team. But it looks like they're actually heading up top. Defend their own tier 1, head into the tier 1 up here, stop the Batrider from farming away freely.
Yeah, but spreading the map is a little bit dangerous here. Like, Come With Me could be an easy pick. The Blink Dagger isn't up for Weeha yet, though. He's got the Aghanim Scepter for now. And he's keeping most of the Meepos in base. Do you think there's an efficiency problem there, or is it just a temporary setback?
I'm not too sure. With the jungle being pretty free, you know, we've not seen Bird United come in here. I've been expecting it for a long time, so maybe that's what we are thinking as well. They've got one ward scouting out movement into the jungle, but if they smoke up and find one of those little guys farming away, that's Weeha's farm stopped for a good 30, 40 seconds.
Definitely. It's better to lose a couple of camps that you could be farming in order to make sure that you're not feeding, and that's going to be his decision there. It looks like it's going to be the Blinko Come With Me, and that was their weak point. They're going to press it.
Pretty easy kill down onto that little Vengeful Spirit. Tier 1 to fall, but up at top lane. Soshka has the call onto Yapsil. Fissure holds him in place for long enough for it to turn around, dunk down from Paris, and now Exist needs to bail the hell out of here. Overgrowth won't catch the storm. My nuts. Tried his hardest, but could not succeed.
Yep, so now in this position to kind of still go on the tier 2 with this regen rune if they wanted to, but they've got to bottle up the axe, but no, just limping away. He's too low for their taste, and that is just going to be the tier 1 push and leaving him down bottom. Down bottom, it's going to be actually the Shadow Shaman to drop the wards and essentially suicide as he's getting TP'd on hard.
Is it a suicide? Weeha's coming in. Deterrent, possibly? The TP's are still coming. Okay, Sasuke gets the two-man call. Oh, Weeha, you stuck around too long. Tries to turn back around to the Binance, but he just goes invis. And Snare will keep them in vision as Weeha poofs again, fighting through, killing many people. Can he actually sustain through it all? Sasuke and Berserker's call. They finally kill Weeha. But he fought up almost 1v4 there.
Yeah, he almost had 3 kills there. That was actually really close calls, right? Great usage of the Earthbind to keep the Treant in vision and lock him down, and that's a tanky Treant, so you have to be wary of that fact. But no, he just goes ahead, and they commit to that tower, don't get much more than 2/3 of the HP, and they lose 2 lives and the Mass Serpent once for it. So more time Weeha's not farming, but it's only a few creeps away from the blink, and he's going to be out in the battle again.
Just wondering, you know, if Storm Spirit was nearby, if they had Yapzor there with a Fissure, Weeha could have run away with a Rampage.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, 2 people so low, and I don't know, it's just like, that's why I questioned in the first place, was they essentially, with that TP potential, they committed to the tower that just, they can't 2v5, but it is what it is. Right now, they're just trying to find any opportunity they can, and mistakes will be made in the process.
Tier 1 at mid, finally gonna fall here. Necroman, Yule's Mech, Full Souls, Requiem level 2, which is actually on cooldown right now. Oh, they used it at bot lane, of course. Take the tier 1 pretty easily as Sing Sing has finally entered the Radiant Jungle. Now they'll start to do what they did last game, just taking full control of the farm, and Necroman stunned up. They know he has Aegis Immortal, so there's no point in throwing your mana and cooldowns to try and kill him, because, you know, he's just gonna pop himself back up.
There's another reason why the Axis farm is so important. It's not just for this Blink Dagger, but it's how he tanks up after the fact. He just now pulled out the Vanguard, but I believe the next item should be the Crimson. Combining Crimson Guard with the Requiem of Souls, those Meepos are going to be hitting for almost nothing for a very long time. Like, he's going to have a Butterfly or an E-Blade, at least the Scotty, to be hitting above 0 damage, honestly. Like, right now, if he gets 100 damage, it's reduced in half by the Requiem, and then it's blocked by 50. That's 0 damage coming in from the Meepos other than their Geostrike passive.
Ow. So he's going to rely on building up into that Hex as quickly as he can, I guess, and then go and find the solo pickoffs. You blink in, queue up that Hex, poof the rest of your Meepos out. But Necroman, once he's out of the Hex, he can try and dodge with the Yules. He can heal up with a Mech. Sasuke, like you mentioned, Vanguard makes him a lot tankier. The damage output, he's going to try to focus down someone like the Vengeful Spirit. Even Minots, with 1500 HP, he's 1,000 gold away from his Aghanims.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it's a good point to mention that the Hex disables a damage block, so Vanguard and Crimson won't be as useful once the Scythe is available, unless the PL is able to defuse it off.
Well, Yapzor, Blink Dagger is 200 gold away from him. Both a great aggressive and defensive item. You can save your teammates, but also jumping in here, Phantom Lancer Illusions, oh, speaking of taking down the Rasta down at bot lane, while Weeha blinks himself into the trees and moves himself back to the fountain.
So he's got the potential to farm up top here. It's not Meepo Prime, but it still will do, getting the last hits with the poof, and just keep on moving through. Maybe even try to address the jungle, since they have this Radiant Observer Ward giving a little bit more intel. They see some people down bottom, they see the Axe was moving up top, and it's a tough kill because this hero is designed to live through everything, but I think they have enough magic damage to do it.
Do they know where he is?
Yeah, he's sneaking.
Sasuke hiding in the trees. Storm Spirit can give vision with the Remnant if he gets close enough. Yapzor has already blinked over the top to try and find an opening. Okay, TP's coming in. Yapzor caught. Sasuke gets the call onto Attila and Yapzor as he jumps in now. Here comes Necroman. Nope, stopped with a Fissure. No Requiem of Souls for him. As the couple of razors come out, big old Echo Slam though on the 3. Overgrowth catching 2, but now the dying Requiem will finish off the Storm and Earthshaker. 2 have fallen on both sides, but Serpent Wards trap in Minot. Sing Sing has finally joined in the fight to bring down a third. Treant, yeah, you're screwed. Sing Sing tries to double gang over the trees, will succeed. Not caught. The Earthbind was inches away as that fight ends, what, 3 for 3?
Yeah, I mean, they are able to get 2. If you get the Treant Protector was in a different fight recap, but with the 3 for 3 kill factor applying to 2 cores rather than 2 supports, it's going to be like 800 gold in favor of BBC, and obviously a lot more experience since they were at a deficit. And it's just going to be getting actual map control, because they are able to take towers off of that. They're able to start fighting in the enemy jungle, and they're feeling a lot better about it themselves after a play like that. I gotta say, the Echo Slam was really the difference maker. A couple of stuns came out of Shadow Fiend, preventing the Requiem early, and that's what really makes the difference in the end. Axe goes down, and everybody else kind of follows through. But Phantom Lancer's still farming up pretty hardcore. Yasha, Manta is going to be his next item pickup. And I wanted to talk about this earlier, but now we're kind of actually going to be seeing it pretty soon. Minot's with the Aghanim Scepter. Do you think it's going to give them the utility they need?
I don't know. I think one of the biggest things here is getting vision of that Meepo. Knowing where he's farming, knowing where his prime Meepo is, so they know when he's going to blink in and try and catch someone out. He's closing in on that Hex. He's got the ultimate orb and Bloodstone's done on the Storm, but I think outside of the damage it gives and the farm potential, obviously, when you spam them out in the enemy jungle, you limit the farm.
Yeah, no, he's not going to use it like that, I don't think. But
It's going to be all down to knowing where that surprise jump is from the Meepo. So now the Ventral Spirit, you can start thinking, okay, well, once he's got Aghanims, I don't have to buy so many wards. I don't have to expend this much gold on observers. I can start building into something bigger and better for myself.
Yeah, I like the idea that also Overgrowth, at being able to use it at long range is pretty good, because it will cancel poofs out and I'll lock down somebody for a blink. But Masakari will be caught by the Yules, so he will be going down. And I was about to talk about the value of his gem, but if he loses it here, then not so much. Gem of True Sight going away, and who was able to actually pick it up in the end?
Does that come with me? Yeah. Ventral Spirit takes that up. Exist. Earthblind nearly landing on Soshka. Stun out now. A couple of raises. I don't know if they can finish him off, though, as in comes Weeha. Necroman pops his initial BKB. Requiem of Souls will drop Weeha pretty low. The raises. Yep, they'll finish off the Meepo. They're still all alive as Bird United are battling through everything. Storm, jeez, how much mana do you have? He's got plenty.
Yeah, if they could lock down the blink, the Earthshaker on top, they'd be feeling really good about a push. But again, that Echo Slam is still something that they have to be worried about. So they check the pit. It's a very late Roche spawn. It is going to be just 20 seconds from now. And yeah, that is that's 2 out of 3 minutes into it. So it's not as late as it could be, but it's pretty deep into it. And they were looking for an earlier timer. But in either case, yeah, some big items are going to come out on the back of that. The Aghanim Scepter should be done for Kriant soon. And the bigger thing, I think, is they got the gem. I was about to talk about how Batrider with a gem will see those Eyes of the Forest. He'll be able to Firefly or Force Staff through them and clear those out no problem. But since they just handed it over before the Axe comes out, these could actually stay up, and in doing so, provide them lots of intel.
What's the cooldown on Gem right now? 6.5 minutes. It's a pretty long time to go without it, so they'll definitely be looking to try and focus down Minot in these teamfights to bring it back, or maybe find a pickoff on him. I say that, I don't think he really should be the focus in teamfights now, thinking about it. You've got Sing Sing and Necroman to deal with, while Minot, you know, he's scary, he's a big old tree man, but in an actual team fight, he's not the guy you go, okay, he's going to make the biggest impact here. Exist. Spots out the smoke. Good old Fisher from Yapzor. Oh, into the Echo Slam. Catches 3. In jumps Exist. Masakari finds the lasso down to Necroman, but he's stunned up. Overgrowth holds him in place. And Burden. Looks like they'll be fighting through this just fine. Take down the Batrider. Storm. Can't find anyone to kill, but Meepo in the back lines. Does spot out.
Oh, no.
Requiem. Requiem. They can't take
it. Nice, Fisher. Fisher comes out. They stop the Requiem for a while. It finally does come through. Weeha at about half HP on all the Meepos here, but they can't finish it. They're controlling the fight really well. Sing Sing kills off Earthshaker on the side, but they're going to bring down the Shadow Fiend. They're bringing down Come With Me. The Meepo still falls. Sing Sing's still in it. He will go down to the Aether Shuck, and that is going to be a near wipeout from Burden United. It's going to be Minuts in retreat. He should be fine, but the Gem of True Sight is still on the field. It's not in anybody's inventory. Where did it end up?
Gem. Who's got the gem? Did it go back onto the courier?
Courier. It's on the dark courier. They snatched it back up. Very nice. They might not even brought it to that fight, which would have been even better from them. And they're starting to drop those Eyes of the Forest. So the big thing there for that team fight was the amount of control the Earthshaker brought. Yapzor won that fight for them handily. And the other thing was the hesitance of Weeha to jump into a Crimson Guard. It was very clear that when the Crimson was up, he could have blinked into five people, but he knew that would be a mistake. He tries to isolate somebody, still gets taunted pretty hard, and in the end goes down, but it's the focus the entire lineup of Burden United puts into him that actually makes it a successful fight for BBC.
Well, I couldn't agree with you more. That Earthshaker was pivotal in that team fight. He got two exceptional fishes. The Echo Slap. Oh, they've caught someone. They've got Minots.
Oh,
they've caught him, and they've got a gem back as well. Exist will take him out. Batrider, reclaim what is rightfully yours. No, actually he won't.
No, they're not gonna... Oh wait, the Storm has it.
Storm has
okay,
it,
okay, so
yeah.
they did pull it out. Okay, I thought they'd leave it on the courier for a long while. Kind of, you think of it like you're essentially this Treant Protector. He thinks of himself like a techie. So he's dropping things that he doesn't want people to see and scout out. You want that gem to stay in your base. So
yeah.
I kind of feel they should have left it there, but in the end it goes into another's hands and Meepo takes the easiest roast of his life.
Pretty damn easy. What does Weehaw have? Something's flying in on the courier?
Should be Hex, right?
No,
it's... Okay, that's different. Everybody has a piece of that courier here. It's going to be Aghanim's Scepter for Shadow Shaman, the Storm Spirits working on his Hex or Lincoln's, most likely Hex, and then Weehaw is just carrying an Ultimate Orb for now.
Where's Weehaw's gold? Because he's had the Ultimate Orb for a long, long time.
Well, I mean, his net worth is still, like, at the level of Phantom Lancers, and Phantom Lancer isn't, like, a full item ahead here. He's still... You can kind of ask the same question. Sing's got an Ultimate Orb on the Courier, so he's got Manta, Diffusal, Vlad's, and I'd say that's about on par with what you're seeing from Meepo here.
Okay. It just kind of felt that after that last team fight, I guess it didn't go that well for Meepo. He's still sitting at 2, 4, and 7, 200 CS, and...
A big aspect of that is the AoE gold bounty only works if you're dead, or if you were alive at the time, or if you had a bloodstone, and he died. He was one of the first heroes to die. He's the second hero to die, I think. So, although they cleaned up that fight, Weehaw didn't get any benefit in terms of assists.
Oh well. He's still got a decent way to go. They'll try and find a pickoff on someone who defends this bottom tier 2 tower. They're all ready and waiting around. The trouble is, this dire eye in the forest has spotted them out. Or spotted the majority of them anyway. Weehaw walked into the tier 2 and they'll definitely feel his presence as they're pushing up onto high ground. Surely they'll back themselves up, take Ancients, go back into the jungle. That Hex on the Meepo is definitely going to be a vital pickup for them.
Yeah, it still could be the Scotty, but with the Crimson Guard problems, if he understands the mechanic of block versus Hex, it's important to get as many Hexes as you can in this case so he can actually deal the damage.
We've also seen
because right now Crimson Guard breaks his damage down to like 47%, not even counting armor, and then with the Requiem it takes it down to like 10%, like 5%.
We've also seen Weehaw go Manta Meepo. This is like his second item after Aghanim's, or third after Aghanim's Blink, if you want to look at it that way. It does cause a lot of havoc in team fights, but against Overgrowth and Berserker's Call, I don't really think that's the way to go. So it's definitely going to be one of the two, Scardy or Hex. Lasso. They found my nuts again, and they'll bring them down with ease as Treant drops his life to BBC. That's him on the sidelines now for 50 seconds with no buyback. Oh, can Burden actually mount a defense here? They've got Axe Blink, but Serpent Ward's onto the high ground. Weehaw hammering away with Aegis the Immortal.
Well, they've got the BKB on Necroman. If he doesn't get disabled, he should be able to get a good Requiem off, and that's what they need. They need a taunt, they need the Requiem, but it's an Aegis Meepo. It's so hard. They've got the wards, at least. Yeah, all of them are going to be hitting the Rax. They're going to go on Necro without the BKB.
Swap back by Come With Me, but Rax are falling. Melee Rax is already dead. Weehaw will lose his first life. It'll come back with
back
a vengeance. Does Destruction... Whoa. Wait, what? Oh, he had his main Meepo back there. Okay.
Yeah, exactly. The main Meepo Prime is where they're all respawn at, and he made sure that one was out of the fight entirely. So they see the Treant respawning, don't want to be part of an Overgrowth fight, and they end up getting the Rax anyway, so that works out for them nicely. Hex comes out for the Meepo, and they can wait for the next Roche cycle. This is going to be the Roshan fight that might decide the game. I believe we're on the clock for that one here. Not much is going to happen. As I say that, Necroman right in there with the Yule's BKB, but getting lassoed before he can wreck.
And Soshka hexed up. He's going to try and run. Requiem is popped, and they might find the Shadow Shaman here, but it's not really the target they want to go for. Shackles up Soshka, trying to allow the incoming Meepo. Deals the damage down to Shadow Fiend, who nearly pops, but gets the make off just in time. We are now dropping low. PL chasing him down and will drop that Meepo as Yapzor is on the retreat, exists, and Masakari trying to fight through it. Burden is stuck in the fire and the flames, but it doesn't matter at all. Sing Sing has not been taken down. He's got the mana. He's got the sustain. As he rips through BBC's ranks, in jumps Paris. Oh, they found it again. Stun, slam, dead. Yap saw him with a big blink into end champ.
Block
him, but man.
Vanguard OP.
Man, oh man.
They can't even get one in return. Now it's going to be the big storm jump back in. The Bloodstone respawn. He wants one. Anything he gets, Sig Sing, he won't get Come With Me. Two will retreat out of there. And that's obviously a lot of Bloodstone charges that he lost from to be back in the fight so quickly. But yeah, as it stands, still, I mean, they're down the racks. They have to make some big plays happen. And right now they have a pretty big timeout phase. It really... Again, emphasizing the next Rosh, that is going to be the fight that will most likely decide the game.
That went from BBC taking out Rax at bot to a big old fight from Burden, actually wiping BBC, then Storm Spirit suddenly finding two kills because he respawned instantly and with his 2,000 mana pool zips across and kills them off. Who is actually in the lead right now? BBC still have an okay lead. It's nothing sizable. It's nothing that's really going to keep them in the game. But item progression-wise, you've got to feel that the two hexes now up for BBC, one on the Meepo, one on the Storm. The fact that they've got this long-range initiation, they can lock down Shadow Fiend or PL before they can make that move into the middle of the team fight. There's going to be no Doppelganger to try and pick off the Batrider or Earthshaker. There's going to be no walk into Requiem, especially because Necro didn't go for the blink. His mobility is very limited.
I honestly think BBC are pretty far ahead right now. I would say maybe 60-40 or 65-35. BU still have a really good shot at this, but they need to get their spells off. Overgrowth, Berserker's Call, Requiem, all very important here. BBC spells are a lot easier to execute on. You're gonna get a lasso in a fight. You're going to get a couple good fishers. The ward's going down with splash damage. Like, they just seem to be doing better, and these hexes are going to allow pickoffs. So when it comes down to the fights, BBC have a slight edge. When it comes down to the pickoffs, BU don't stand a chance.
Well, BU still have all of these little eyes in the forest, scouting everyone out, won over by the secret shop even. But the majority of them are on the dire side of the map. They're all pretty super defensive, just watching out for whether Meepo's farming up their own jungle, whether Storm is waiting to zip in onto someone. There's no aggressive warding until now. Okay, Come With Me. He's gone for it. Aggressive ward down in the Radiant Jungle. Gonna watch out onto that tier 2 as well. But up at tier 2 top, BBC, they're looking to push into tier 3 again. A little bit risky without that Rosh, though.
Yeah, I definitely think the Aegis is a pretty key aspect of their high ground strat. I mean, maybe there's confidence. Maybe they know that half the team is not even there. TP's on everybody, though, so they'll rally very, very shortly.
Serpent Wars do a ton of damage, though. They need Shadow Fiend to get up in there and clear them out, which he will do with ease, but that baits him in. Soshka caught with the lasso, swap back from Come With Me.
Nice.
Saves him and keeps him healthy. Doesn't look like they'll be...
Yeah, I think that just breaks down from here. Oh, he can't blink! The blink was 1 second, and now the Yules.
And there's no Force Staff either. Batrider drops, the gem is on the ground, except Exist zips it and picks it up. Okie dokie.
Beautiful pickup from Exist. That was very impressive, actually. Needed that one to make sure that they can maintain any semblance of control. Because you look at the minimap, and it's still already pretty bad. But Storm's another hero that can clear out trees really easily. Ball Lightning. So as long as he actually makes his rounds through the jungle, he should see that. And Weeha narrowly making an escape.
Yeah, we saw the long-range overgrowth there, just locking down Weeha for a short while. But Come With Me Hex, so he couldn't stun. Soshka didn't manage to find that blink call in time. Could have been a decent pickoff, because right now, buybacks are going to be super important. We've got buyback on the PL and the Meepo, as well as Shadow Fiend and Axe. So the Dire... Okay, well, Storm Spirit is 7 gold away from buyback. And with a Bloodstone, he doesn't necessarily need it. It's going to be, what, like a 30-second respawn time with the 11 Bloodstone charges. Not too shabby.
I mean, he's got a lot of charges to work with. He's going to heal up his allies when he goes down. He'll be respawning quick, and it just doesn't cost him as much. But they're going to try to make the play happen. He exhausts a lot of mana, can get the Hex out, but there's so many heroes here.
Oh, this is risky. They get the lasso down onto Soshka. Good swap back from Come With Me, though. Exist. Enough mana to zip himself out. Shadow Shaman, who's your target? He's going to zap down Come With Me, not finish him off, though, as Treant in the back lines is still being hunted by the Storm and the Batrider. Everyone's going with a different target. Yule's up, Requiem, Meepo, finding Soshka over in the side, dropping low, though, to a lance from Sing Sing, and yep, Illusions finish him off. While over in the back, Necroman is killed off by the remainder of BBC. Everybody, literally everybody, was on a different target.
Yeah, it was so spread out. And the big thing here was Sing Sing was still farming the Ancients. He could have jumped over the cliff to join his allies, but he wanted the fight to stay segregated. And it was actually the Meepo that jumped onto Sing. So he was pursuing, but Sing is able to doppel the first initiation. Manta's out of the Earthbind for the second. And it's only the Hex that allows Meepo to catch up. But Axe was, I'm assuming there was some really good communication coming in between Sing Sing and Toshkovac, because he was able to just narrowly, with 20% HP left, save Sing Sing's life with a huge call, and Weehaw dies in the end of it. So, although the fight on the Western Front did end pretty poorly for Birdie United, the survival of Sing Sing and the death of Weehaw really tips the scales back into Birdie United's favor. Now they've got the BKB up on the Axe, so it's only going to be Geostrike and Scotty that really limits his movement in the fights. And yeah, I mean, as long as the PL gets to another item pretty soon, I could still see them really bringing this one back. Shadow Fiend, he's got an ultimate orb. Do you see him going Scotty, another Hex? What are we looking at here?
I'm not too sure. You could go whatever the hell you want to. Hex would be nice up against the Storm Spirit, against Shadow Shaman and Batrider. Once they zip in, you get that instant disable. Scotty, I'm kind of in two minds about this item in general. On a Shadow Fiend, especially if you're going for this Yule's Mech BKB build setup, you're really lacking damage. Then if you finish things off with, Scaldi and Butterfly, sure enough, you've got Souls, which adds to your actual physical rifling damage. The magic damage from Razors is decent, but once it starts hitting late game, you want something like Daedalus, you want Satanic, you want these big, hard-hitting items.
You see what's happening right now? They're getting the free Roach. The Aegis and Cheese are going to the Meepo, and that might just decide the next fight without any contest at all. I can't believe they weren't trying to contest that. Like, I feel like they have a decent chance at it, but they just couldn't get to the place they needed to, and now this is going to be so difficult to deal with. Going in, Meepo is now... He doesn't have the Scotty yet, but he does have the Sheep, the Blink, the Ags, and that's enough because he gets that second respawn. It's going to be so hard to bring him down twice. At that point, I mean, you don't ignore a Meepo, but you don't focus him either. It's just they're in a really difficult position if BBC push with his Aegis.
They've got a Quelling Blade on the Batrider. He doesn't want to waste Firefly to kill off these Eyes in the Forest, so Storm's running around with a gem saying, hey, look, Bat, there's one here. Go and use... Oh, jump in. Soshka finds one of the Weehaw clones. Sing Sing throws a lance in, but I don't know about this. I don't know about this. Soshka's now caught on the wrong side of the fissure as the rest of BBC zipping back, zipping forth. Soshka's found Levy again. I don't know. Rasta dies.
They're going to win it.
He's placed his wards. Paris now caught inside of them as exist. Vortex back, pops the cheese. Paris still surviving. Oh! He's on 50 HP and he still won't go down. Necroman right clicking through the rest of the fight as Weehaw runs his little legs away.
Yeah, he just abandoned his team. Like, straight up, he was down to 40% HP on one of his meepos. He is the Aegis carrier, and he says, my Aegis is more important than your lives. The storm goes down, quick respawn again, and the Shadow Shaman, he'll be up pretty soon. In the meantime, some tier 4 damage and some buildings drop down in the Dire base, and they're constantly just having to worry about the pressure coming in from that bottom lane. BBC can still make the offensive play. As far as their cooldowns go, they need to get the Mass Serpent wards up. That's the key thing. So in 70 seconds, they should be looking to take either the top or mid lane Arrax. Probably top since it's the most exposed. And in that situation, I think they prevail, but only if the wards go down and the Meepo commits.
Well, they had to use the cheese on the Storm Spirit. They've lost a bunch of charges on him as well.
Yeah, a ton. He was rocking so many charges.
And the gem. Again, we come back to this fact that the gem was there and the gem was lost. Have they bought a new one?
There's two gems, yeah. One on the courier, one on the ground in the Dire base.
Oh, they've taken both of them. Both of them belonging to the Radiant. Oh, boy. PL bought himself up a Scotty, while Shadow Fiend, we saw him pick up one as well. So they're tanking up. They've got that kiting ability, and it allows you to turn around team fights. You know, BBC, they rely on that one hit kill, jump in with the initiation and deal their damage out like that. While BU, if they can tank through that first hit, counter initiate with Soxica, get the Axe blink in and call. If Storm and PL survive, they've got the tools at their disposal to turn these fights around.
So, I mean, it's an interesting map sword right now. Necro's with the Scotty, is happy to push out down bottom. Has the come with me watching him just in case they need to he needs to blink to the tree line and swap the Shadow Fiend out. But as it is right now, they're just trying to push out the lane so they can delay the Aegis. Anytime that, like, they say, oh, we have to defend our 2-2 bottom, that's a minute lost in their push time. And that's the valuable seconds when it comes to this Meepo second life.
They're all grouped up, but they've all been scouted out.
What's up? No! They man up?
We're going to try and fight. Requiem will not!
No.
Oh, mistimed. As we see over in the Dire Jungle now, Sing Sing caught out, hexed up and locked in that Earthbind. Lasso will keep him held in place. Can we all finish him off though? Doppelganger? Yep. Saved him for a second. Good blink and a call though from Soshka. Sing Sing surviving through everything. Will manage to run himself away as Midas is now the focus. But Weeha is dropping low. Weeha has one clone that's sitting on about 200 HP and Sing Sing returns back in. The hex from Weeha not going to be enough as the Meepo drops. Aegis expires. Well, Aegis is used and now, where does he go? Where does he run? Soshka is focused down by the Storm Spirit. Come with me, a Necroman have jumped into this team fight. Meepo? He's dead. He's not dead. He's not actually dead because the Suicide from Storm keeps him alive for about 3 seconds longer. But in the end, throwing lives away. Bodies into the meat grinder there from BBC and...
really?
Just didn't work out.
No. I mean, the Phantom Lancer was so close to being brought down. They thought they had it with the fact that there was so much spread out to the bottom lane, but they both had TPs, got back into it. This tier 2 proxy still stands and they keep staying in the fight. The axe makes the plays happen, and now they're pushing in for the win. Meepo has buyback. They're going to try to force it, and I believe that's exactly what's going to happen. So we've got
Swap
coming in. He has the Blink Dagger. He'll be okay, but it is close. It is really close at hand. Any misstep could be their last, but at least for the moment, Burden United, they are going to be falling back and farming, getting the Ancients taken care of. Cleared out by Sing Sing, and another gem, the third gem of the game for BBC.
They've had enough. They've had enough of being scouted out every step of the way, because I feel like the main reason that fight did go south for BBC. Sure enough, they started off with a great Hex and Earthbind and all that, but they got seen by this Eye in the Forest. They're getting scouted out every time they move in. Just look at the freaking map. It's red leaves everywhere.
Nearly global overgrowth is really huge. Obviously, no Manta on Weeha, and even then it would only break one Meepo free. So, yeah, at this point they are worried that they might have to all in this. It's going to be another couple minutes before the Roche respawns, and I still feel that those resources, Aegis and Cheese, are the way they end this game. Otherwise, it's just going to be 6-slotted PL, 6-slotted Shadow Fiend, and although Meepo is big, he can only do so much.
And Meepo, he's definitely a mid-game hero. He farms fast, he gets his experience and gold up really quickly. But we see a lot of the time, once it hits 50 minutes, Meepo's capped out and he doesn't really offer too much. Sure enough, he's still got Hex, he's still got this utility. Locking down the heroes without BKBs with the Earthbind. Magic damage is great up against the Treant and Vengeful Spirit, but they're tanking up. Come with me has a blink. Treant is he really? Is he really going Aghanim's Refresher?
I would much rather see a Blink Dagger on him too, but I mean, most fights are happening near the Eyes in the Forest, so I guess it's acceptable to go this route, and if it works, it'll work. I mean, locking down the Meepo twice over, it's a great late-game decision. It's a difficult one because if you don't have the Eyes and you can't walk your way into the fight, it might be zero ultimates that are effective, but if they are within the tree's range, or if you get in a position where you can make use of it with even another swap for it, I don't even know, but if you get there, then you can double overgrowth and it'll completely shut down BBC.
Well, they've got to TP people back and defend their tier 3 mid, tier 2 bot. Oh, the ping goes out. They know where Exist is. They're going to blink call. They can't find him yet. They know the camp's cleared. Yule Scepter, Necroman. Oh my god, it's so close.
Yeah, that's a gem again. Third gem. They've been using it to clear out the entire Dire Jungle. You can see there are no red leaves in that vicinity, and that's because Batrider and Storm were on the tree-cutting crew. Kimbersaw would be proud.
There are trees everywhere. Well, Exist definitely making it his life's work to go around. Overgrowth, it's kind of one of those things like, hey you, hey you, stop. Stop, please.
That, and also farmed the jungle. He took out three camps there, almost took out that fourth one in the Radiant side. Yeah, yeah, I was saying that he's not really going to use it to farm because he needs the cooldown to disable, but when he sees them all huddled in their base, he says, okay, why not take all your camps and leave you nothing.
Well, Sing Sing, he's got another 2.5k gold. Mantis style BKB was his most recent item. And up against the Storm Spirit, and especially the Meepo, I feel here. The double hex, but the poof damage coming out, definitely necessary. It does indicate, obviously, which one's the real one, but at this stage of the game, that's not such an issue. You know, earlier on, when you want to be a little sneakier, you want to be farming safely, then sure. But in these head-on-head clashes, where you're literally running 5 into 5, having that BKB is going to be a massive deal. Shadow Shaman, warding up, and will... I think he saw Minots go invisible there, but not too sure. Storm has successfully cleared now about 70% of these eyes.
So, 20,000 net worth Meepo switches over to BOT. Still sitting on a casual ultimate orb, though. That's nice stats, but he needs more. He needs the Scotty. He needs to be able to survive through the fights, and that's got to be some farming time. He wants buyback. He wants Scotty. And it's expensive at this stage because his farm just hasn't been that above average because of all the overgrowth and eyes. If he didn't have to worry about all these eyes in the forest, he would be farming a jungle and a half constantly. But instead, he's suppressed. He's caught in where all the meeples are clustered up in fear of a gank. And as a result, his farm is actually significantly less than Sing Sing's.
Ghost Scepter and full staff up on the Shadow Shaman. How are we looking net worth wise? And I only say this out of interest. I don't feel like the metrics really indicate who's in the lead. But Burden do have a 5k lead. Experience wise, they're a little further ahead. But overall, it's going to be one fight that defines it. You know, one fight and then who has buybacks. Which in this case, almost everyone does. Rasta, Treant, and Storm Spirit are the only ones without. But Earthshaker. Dropping low, Enchant Totem, but it's not going to slow anyone down.
And now he's going to have to buy back for the Roche fight if they want to even try to take it, which they definitely should.
We've seen all these free Roshans go the way of BBC, but the one that really matters, the one closest to the end of the game. Burden
is going to go for Snatch. He's not. I mean, he could drop the bottle, drop a stick, Aegis and Cheese.
Come on. Drops the bottle. He's going for it. HP on Roche is dropping drastically. I don't know. Vision? Vision is non-existent. It's dead. Cheese? Nope. Not even going to get that. Exist jumps himself away. The illusions go up onto the high ground. And one of them is actually chasing him down. Phantom Rush? Pretty nuts skill.
it's a pretty ridiculous skill and its full potential. But right now, chasing isn't going to be the issue. It's just about starting the fight on their terms and... You got a Cheese Axe now. You've got Aegis on Shadow Fiend. So you're going to get the Requiems in the fight. You're going to get a half Requiem when he dies. You're going to get the full Requiem when he comes back at the very least, if not before that. And that's going to be making it difficult for the Meepo. Like, Meepo can be 6-slotted, and it's still... He's very limited in the fact that he runs so much base damage against Shadow Fiend. Well, right now, the math, I mean, you get 70, all of your Meepo Prime does 150 damage, your secondaries are the same. So 75 or 76 damage once Requiem hits you. And Levi looking for a pick. It looks like that's not going to happen if he gets overgrowth.
Oh man, Meepo comes in, Hex and Poof will take down the Shadow Fiend's first life. And can they get out of here? They're poofing away, there's no slow, there's no stun, there's nothing to actually stop them. So a great jump in and jump out as they take down Shadow Fiend's Aegis the Immortal. Butterfly was on its way already. So he doesn't have buyback, actually.
Yeah. That definitely is unfortunate, but at the same time, you have to commit your life at this stage in the game. You have to say, get the items that you need to win it out, and Butterfly is one of the best items against Meepo, because he can't just MKB illusions. Oh, okay.
Swap back, come with me, saves my nuts. As the Fissure comes in, Yapzor Echo Slam onto two. The two supports has come with me and my nuts to drop in. Exist? He's stuck there for a short while, as Necroman did pop the Requiem. But it looks like, again, that's a quick in and out. Okay, maybe not. Maybe not so quick as Yapzor gets caught in the call and a couple of razors will seal the deal with the Culling Blade. But Burden, they've lost Aegis on the Shadow Fiend. They've lost the two supports. They can't go and take objectives now as three. Maybe they can push out creep waves, but there's no real...
Yeah, no, this should be the last wave. If they go in further, they're committing suicide. They gave the cheese over to Shadow Fiend, so I think he's still in an okay position here. It's a 5-second BKB, so all in all, once they respawn, I think it's kind of a reset. We're still in a position where the Aegis isn't going to be enough of a factor. But, I mean, Shivas are already up for the Storm Spirit. Soon enough, we'll be up for the Axe. And that's another critical timing, I suppose. Or they could you go AC on the Axe here instead? Do you think that would be more profitable for them?
It's gonna help push high ground. You get the minus armor on towers, you can take down creep waves a little bit faster. I don't know, though. Because with the Shivas, like you say, like slowing down the Meepo's attacks.
Oh, they caught him! They caught the Meepo! Can he poof? No!
There's no Requiem, there's nothing! Necromancer's gonna die here! Weehaw jumps in! Okay, geez, they give it over Paris now. Trying to do something with the TP out from Weehaw. Poof, 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 and out he goes. Minots, Overgrowth wasn't in range.
And that's the Blink Dagger, man. That's what I'm talking about. But now we have the Death of the Shadow Shaman. Not as critical as the cheese and BKB being popped by the Shadow Fiend, but still a momentary opportunity where they can say, let's go full offensive. It's not going to be a sneaky Shadow Shaman dropping Serpent Wards on our racks and taking care of it. It's going to be a fight in the base, and maybe that's something they can take. They have no cheese, no Aegis, and 40 seconds on Overgrowth. That's the timer of Shadow Shaman's life. They can't actually do it without the Overgrowth, I don't think. Tier 2 is all they can grab.
Yapzor feels it coming. He buys himself a couple of smokes. He's got Echo Slam in 2 seconds' time. He is going to be the last bastion of hope here to defend the base, really. Jump in with a big Echo Slam.
Going right into the base. Man, they're just going to go back. They're just going to say, okay, no, there's no way you're going to rat this one out. We'll take tier 2. We'll fall back.
Ballsy, ballsy play. Weehaw and Exist. Well, actually, Burden are still down on the spot lane.
Yeah, I don't... I mean, they can't... I don't think they can. Yeah, they're just going to back it off. Double damage rune is a pretty big deal on the field. If Meepo gets that, it's a god rune. So they have to, at the very least, deny that from him. If not, maybe go for like a bottle play to make it useful for themselves. But just deny it is probably the right play. Both see it with wards and trees. This is such a tense game, man. This has gotten down to the wire. E-Blade soon up for Meepo, and then he's 6-slotted. You don't get much bigger than this on the Meepo. And that's not a bad thing, because he can still do so much work, but his progression will be at max. And it's actually one thing is the position of his Meepos now, it should not be around his teammates. He should keep them all in the fountain, because the way the experience works is level 25 heroes still take their share of experience. Mm-hmm. And level 25 Meepos take multiple shares of their experience, many, many helpings. And it's got to be frustrating for the level 16 Shadow Shaman, Earthshaker, 19 Batrider. Like, they still want to improve their level progression, and Meepos only detracting from that.
Well, you're mentioning six-slotted Meepo. Sing Sing is basically there himself. He sells off the Vlads, he's buying a Butterfly, and in fact, he's got it. The courier has it.
Oh, bottom tree gets scouted out. That's a gem, right? Yeah, onto Exist, so he's going to be able to clear out the Treant and force a buyback there.
Sing Sing has to go and pick up the rest of the items from his stash. Weehaw? Requiem and Berserker's Call. Weehaw is caught in the wrong neighborhood, just dunked. And now he's on the sidelines for 80 seconds. He's got buyback available, but that was odd.
Yeah, I mean, you can only keep, when you're trying to farm globally and trying to spread, just keep the waves pushed out, you're gonna overstep at some point, but that loss could have cost them a buyback if BU were pressuring a little bit harder. The big thing here is a Shadow Shaman. Level 3, Aghanim Scepter wards in the base. Not really in range of the tower in full, but still doing a lot of damage to this Axe, whose Vanguard and Crimson does nothing against.
He actually pops his BKB. The Battle Hunger onto a creep as Levy tries to TP himself out, but he's not going to get anywhere.
Pursuing onto the Storm, Magic Missile. Connects. Can they burn enough mana? No. Jumps out very quick and come with these blink. Just puts him in a perfect position to get Fireflood.
He's got swap and he'll swap an illusion. Up onto the cliff.
So yeah, that was the deterrent. The Shadow Shaman making his way with backdoor protection down. You look at that tier 4 tower, it's weak. Shadow Shaman drops wards on that. That tower's gone. The other one's taking hits. So they do back off and they don't get to force Weehaw's buyback. And even more important, because he can use this offensively with his BOTs. He can BOT into the fight. If the creep is killed, he BOTs another Meepo and poofs all of them anyway. So, yeah. Bottom line is Meepo coming back into this game with the buyback with the BOTs could be the play that wins them the game. But I've been thinking that it could be ending within a minute or two for the past 20. So, yeah. It's gotten to a point where they've been at a stalemate for a while, and we'll have to see what's the catalyst for further action.
I'm just looking over on the left-hand side of the map, and these two observe wards that, you know, are more commonly known as Tinker wards, hiding up on the cliff. They're for scouting out Storm Spirit, Meepo, someone hiding in the trees, I'm assuming. But in the meantime, Burden pushing into tier 3 at mid, while Meepo is actually clearing out creep waves down at bot and getting up towards those tier 4s.
They can always fall back, so it's he's able to be in the fight as well as contribute to his team's strategic advantage, which is that bottom racks. Just continuing to push in that weak point, and it's actually going to be exist to a chase. Come with me with the stun.
Oh, wow. Okay. Ballsy play again. They go for the kill on Sing Sing, but they've just not got enough damage. Without Meepo there, with the secondary hanks, without the poof damage, you know, they've got no minus armor. They've got no physical right-click attacks outside of the Meepo. Storm Spirit, okay. He's buying a Demon Edge. He's actually going to try and get an MKB here against the Butterflies from the Dire. But I don't know. They do well in a big head-on-head team fight, sure. Echo Slam proves all the AoE damage they've got. Lasso to pick someone off. But Burden are the guys that have a lot of the actual physical right-click attack power.
It's true. It definitely is. I mean, they are able to still have, with the presence of the Dark Lord, with the fact that PL has some of the highest damage output once all the illusions are on the field with that Diffusal Blade, and it's just, it's very difficult to compete with them at that level. But yeah, Storm's got to contribute to something more than just a walking gem with some good disables, and yeah, we'll see. Smoked up here, Sing Sing. They don't know which one's real, is the big problem.
Can they find the real one? I think they know which one it is now. Right at the front, leading the charge. He's going to try and take down Levy on this Shadow Shaman.
But he's got backup, and that's the big thing here. They're not going to walk into Overgrowth, but... Oh, the Shadow Shaman can't get the wards off! Oh, he's out for 870 seconds!
He gets ripped a new one. Yapsaw gets slammed into the ground as Exist swaps back, but there's no Hex or any instant disable there to lock down the Storm Spirit. Again, two supports down, and... BPC looking a little bit worse for wear, but they've still got Weehar up in this top lane. They've still got his illusions at mid. Burden are having difficulties winning a team fight and then taking an objective.
Okay, the big thing here is at the top rune spawn. When does Weehar collaborate all his meepos to pick this thing up? And with the Dire Observer Ward, can they just kill him now? He picks it up. They're all double damage, all heading for nearly 400, but only one in the overgrowth. He has to fight.
He has to turn. Stunned up. The low one is dropping. He gets the poofs down. Sing Sing. Who does he focus? He can't. The Ghost Scepter's out. E-Blade even. Soshi catches the ball in the call, and that's Meepo down and out. Again, dead for 78 seconds, but he has buyback. He can come back into this. Does he have E-Blade? Yes, he does. I was pretty sure it was.
Yeah, so he is pretty much at the cap, and he's perfectly fine to spend the buyback gold. The cooldown, that's a different story. That's going to be a long time getting back into it, and he relies on Divided We Stand just to reduce that timer. Now the illusion's up, tier 3 is down. He definitely has to buy back, but he wants to make sure Burden can't disengage from it.
Well, when does he go for it? Once you blink, you can't blink lasso now. The battle hunger is perfect timing. BKB's up, Sing Sing's caught now. Swap back from Come With Me once again. He's been on point with these. Levy jumps forward and shackles up. Come With Me. His Minots is taken down by Exist. But
they're fighting without the Meepo. They still don't feel like this fight is committed to, and the Batrider goes down. The Meepo definitely knew the buyback was necessary, but maybe now he's looking at winning the game. Now, instead of preventing loss, maybe he's saying, okay, the only way to win it is to bring two lives to it, so I'm saving my buyback for the base race. I don't know. It's such a difficult position for him to commit that buyback or not to commit that buyback, but it seems like a communication error that they lost the Batrider for it. Like, I understand the idea of don't buy back when they can just disengage and walk away from it, but the team kept going. BBC kept trying to force a fight that that Weehaw didn't want to commit to, and now it's at a very awkward position without the Batrider and with Weehaw isolated. Invisible Axe, perfect, Shiva's Vision.
Found him, call it to Weehaw, Sing Sing runs in. He'll start buyback, he poofs everybody in to try and fight this, but there's no chance he's surviving. Soshka just needs a little more time, in fact, no he doesn't, as Necroman gets the last raise in there. So now, Meepo is still not in a position where he has to buy back. It's going to take a little bit of time for Burden to get up into their base. Mid lane is pushing in with creeps, but Roshan is going to be a freebie here.
Meanwhile, 6-6 illusions are clearing out bottom, so even with the super creeps, it's not going to be giving them momentum. And the H's and Cheese, who do you even give it to now? So many 6 slots, but it's going to be Shadow Fiend?
Adax.
He dropped a mech, I believe, right?
He must have sold his mech a while ago. He removes the Yules and picks up an AC, so he's the one with the AC. Sing Sing has a Reaver on the Courier. What the hell does he drop?
BKB, maybe. It's at 8 seconds still.
Manta?
BOTs and the fights can be dropped, but obviously in a global sense he still needs it. And
He's keeping Satanic for the fight, I guess?
Yeah, I think he has to play some item swap stuff. He's going to BOT forward here, but yeah, which items he has. He's putting on the courier. He's setting the courier forward, even though he could BOT to the fight whenever he wants, because he wants it to be there for the in-fight swap. So I don't know if he BOTs to the front, drops the BOT, picks up the Satanic, or if he actually takes out one of his other combat items.
It looks like his plan. The lines were drawn there by Come With Me. Push out the side lanes, keep the momentum going in our favor, and then we'll think about taking Rax mid. We're not in a rush necessarily to just go, you know, running into the enemy base. We know that BBC are the ones who are desperate to finish this game right now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they have fallen off hard, and they need to make something count. Unless the power suddenly comes out with a refresher or a burst shaker, maybe two. It's just they can't do enough. And so we're looking for the big Echo Slams. We're looking for the big pickoff initiation. A couple of BOTs for Axe, but yeah, it's got to be the perfect initiation for BBC to pull through this one or wait another double damage rune. We saw him actually doing a considerable amount of damage before he got locked down. That double damage rune is just so insane, but it only comes once in a while.
That's the thing, though. When we've seen Meepo do a lot... Oh, man. Yapsaw blinks in to try and clear out the creep wave, but he's caught. He didn't expect Burden to all be here. Ghost Scepter will, you know, allow him to stick around for like 2 seconds longer as Sokshka. He's on the hunt. He wants Batrider, but his blink is on cooldown and he won't find it. Every time we've seen Meepo, you know, go in large, he's been on his own. It's always been one of those situations where it's like, oh, what if they had a Fissure? What if they had the Storm zipping in with, you know, Vortex and a couple of Remnants? What if BBC had been in a position to back up Meepo? But they've never had the chance. They've always been on the defensive a lot of the times, looking for defensive lassos, trying to then go in for objectives.
Batrider getting caught out. He's going to go ahead and get the lasso temporarily, but he can't disengage from this.
Well, in the back, Sing Sing is battling up against the Shadow Shaman. Batrider does fall, and Sing Sing will find
Shadow
a kill.
Shadow Fiend's down too. Weehaw just picked him off.
What?
He just...
What's
he's
doing?
All by himself.
BKB and Requiem. Soshka's here to get the call down. Necroman's surviving through this. He's got the cheese, so he'll... Soshka passing the cheese. Oh, man. The dunk down to Meepo has to buy back. TP in. Try and get into this fight. I don't know. What do you do? Soshka with the Shivas and another dunk for him. Axe, the rest of Burden are here and ready to fight. Swap back onto Exist. Zip forward. No mana. He's got buyback. A minute is too long to stay on the sidelines. Soshka with a sudden triple kill as they're taking Rax, Oh, Yapsaw jumps in with the Echo Slam! Catches three, and now this is the tie. Meepo looks for kills. He takes down one. Shadow Fiend is out, but Meepo's nearly dead. Meepo is dead, and with no buyback, Sing Sing is going to be ripping them to shreds. Attila exists, whatever you want to call him. The Storm Spirit has to get himself the hell out of here as Rax are falling. And it's all down to the Storm and Earthshaker. At this point, Sing Sing is going to be clapping his hands, taking his hands off the keyboard, and letting his hero do the work.
The Earth may quake, but Burden United stand their ground. The throne will fall in the end. Weehaw's Meepo just can't carry it enough. In the end, it's 20,000 gold advantage, 25,000 experience advantage for Burden United. It seemed like the Eyes of the Forest really bought them time across the map to really prevent Meepo from getting to his maximum potential early on. And then obviously the Axe from there, he was the real playmaker in controlling the opposition. Between him, Shadow Fiend, their combos were really good. They won tons of fights off of that, and they got to that full six slot status. So really good micro of the Aegis and the cheese there for Necroman. Yeah. Kind of baited the Meepo in for his first death, and the second death obviously was just some great execution as a whole. Really tough game for Burden United, even if it may be the easiest one of Sing Sing's life. And at the end, it was a hell of a fun to cast with you, man.
Yeah, it's been good. Thanks for joining me. And I just want to point out, that wasn't the first time they swapped the cheese over. I think that was like the second, or... Well, it was definitely the second, maybe even the third time. The Sokshka had the cheese, and moved it over to the Shadowfiend at like the last moment to heal himself up. So definitely Burden pulling out all the stops here to take themselves up to 9-1 in the D2CL European group stages, while BBC now sitting at 3-7, looking a little bit sad down at the bottom of the table. But well, there's still a fair way to go. There's still a fair way to go for them to bring themselves up, get some wins under the belts. Hopefully you guys enjoyed the games tonight. That's it for us for now. There's some more action tomorrow, but what do we actually have over in the D2CL? There's Empire against Hellraisers and Ninjas in Pyjamas against BBC. So we've got some pretty decent matches at the same time tomorrow, starting at 6 p.m. or 5 p.m. So we'll catch you guys tomorrow. Thanks for watching. I've been Durka. You can follow me on Twitter and Facebook at DurkaDota. Joining me, Blaze at BlazeCasting on Twitter. Do you have a Facebook page? Any last shout-outs?
No, that's it, but I do appreciate you bringing me on, and it's really fun to be casting with you guys on the side of joinDOTA. These games from D2CL have been just absolutely a treat, and especially here in the European scene where it's just so active. So once again, thanks for having me, and thanks for all the viewers that tuned in. Wouldn't happen without you guys, so we appreciate you guys too.
Yeah, sweet. Have a good night, everyone. Go and enjoy your dinner or lunch, whatever time of the day it is for you guys. It's 9:30 here. Time to go home, have some dinner, and get myself to bed. Good night, everybody. See you guys tomorrow.